I'm Lori McNichol for the Trim Spa and Highway Patrol.
It is 8 minutes till the hour here in the Imus Homeland program. Here's an America Online. It's the message. Why is it that you saggy old bastards think that your audience wants to listen to you and people like Anna Quinlan drone on about Eminem and Snoop? Do you know how phony and lame that you sound sucking up to these rappers?
Yes.
Yes, we do.
Yes, we do.
You don't believe me, we do.
Believe
better
me.
Than you do.
God almighty.
Here's Sid from Hooters. Good morning, Sid.
Morning, I-Man.
What's going on, baby?
Oh, man. About 10 feet away from me, there are 5 good-looking broads right now putting on their makeup, stuffing their bras.
And you must not be in Hooters.
Yeah. Whatever the hell they call it. Would they import some babes again?
Yeah, they look good today. It's a good-looking crowd today. It's the Christmas crowd.
Yeah.
Santa came early here to Hooters.
Yeah.
You know how just repugnant this whole thing is? Just the whole idea of Hooters and then you being the... I don't know. It's just...
It's troubling. Yes.
Well, I would
if
hope...
If you had a daughter, would you want her to grow up to be a work at Hooters?
Well, let me just say this.
Yeah.
You had Stevie Wonder's mother on the show earlier today.
Yes.
How did Stevie Wonder turn out? Pretty good, right? One of the all-time great artists.
If you were Stevie Wonder's grandfather, would you have wanted his daughter to be a hooker?
Yeah, a hooker.
Would you want your daughter to be bringing degenerates, beer and burgers and some filthy dive?
By bringing people like you, beer and burgers.
Yeah, to Hooters.
It may not be my first choice, but...
No, it wouldn't, would it?
No. Yeah. But I think you should actually do a show from here sometime in February, I mean. I think you'd love it.
Not in your lifetime or anyone else's.
We're here at Hooters.
Yeah. That's not going to happen.
Sure enough, get me some of those wings.
You know what it would take for me to do that?
$10 million to the ranch.
$10 million to the Imus Ranch, and they'd have to wear Imus Ranch T-shirts.
Joining us live, Anna Quinlan. So, Anna.
And then you know who I'd let him talk to?
Howard Feynman here at Hooters.
Deirdre Imus.
Anna, I see you have some pretty nice tatas yourself.
I'd let her go back in the kitchen there and check out those chicken wings. See how that went.
I got a couple of melons over here. Damn it. Oh, no, not those.
So, who won the game last night, Sid?
Tennessee won the game last night, I-Man. Beat the Patriots 24-7. That's going to make Jet fans happy today. And we do have both Marvin Jones and Santana Moss from the Jets. They'll be here live this morning at Hooters, so it's a big, big day. We expect you should be here about 11:30, I-Man.
That sucks. Hey, by the way, I know you're Jewish, but do you have a Christmas tree?
I did.
Well, the answer is yes.
Okay, sure.
So
the hesitation was...
To Chris Dodd and pause.
You're
so.
Always going to ramble.
You're my kind of Jew, Sid.
Yeah.
I do.
Well, I did when I was a kid. I don't really now, but...
It's a mm-hmm. Sid ramble.
Right. Well, does that make me a bad Jew if
no,
I have a
Christmas
tree?
No, of course not.
It means you're just
bacon and eggs on Yom Kippur.
Certainly. Just killed Jesus Christ. That's all right.
to quote my friend Kinky Friedman, we Jews believe it was Santa Claus who killed Jesus Christ.
Great gift. You'll find something for everyone at Walgreens.
Copyright 2002, Infinity Broadcasting, all rights reserved. Imus in the Morning is a presentation of WFAN and Westwood One Entertainment.
The only station with two-way telephone sports talk all day and all night is your flagship station for Imus in the Morning and Mike and the Mad Dog in the afternoon. The Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York, an Infinity Broadcasting station. WFAN 2020 Sports.
Good morning, it's 10 o'clock. I'm Joe Tollison.
888-MHR-INFO.
Six minutes after 10 on a Tuesday Talking Jet show. Live from Hooters on West 56th Street. Smack and Sid on the Fan. I'm Jody McDonald. He would be my partner, Sidney Rosenberg. How are you on this chilly morning, Sidney?
I'm doing pretty good. Chilly. It's absolutely freezing. Chilly is not even the word. I walked out today and I put on the radio and Charles McCord, who must be dyslexic, said it was 42 degrees. Try 24. What are you talking about? Brutal out there today.
It was 42 degrees.
Yeah,
in South Carolina. But here in New York, it was 24. Yeah, it's nasty cold, but it should be warming up. The sun's going to be out all day. I don't think we're going to get up over 32.
Got him free.
Yeah, one more day to go before World War III. The NBA playoffs start tomorrow. The Knicks and the Heat, one of the matchups. They meet in the playoffs for the third straight season. Heat, of course, have home court. Latrell Sprewell was asked if that's important.
I think that, you know, in the past, in the NBA, that might have mattered. I think with the way teams are pretty evenly matched.
And somebody should choke him.
Now that it probably doesn't mean anything.
We have an inarticulate person doing sports. We don't need to hear from him during sports. Just so unusual to have an inarticulate NBA player. Such a surprise. And that's sports. I'm Mike Breen. Okay. Robert Cordero is an attorney practicing in Dunmore, Pennsylvania. Bob founded, owned, and operated five different radio stations, and his was among the first radio stations in the country to broadcast the syndicated Imus in the Morning radio program hosted by one of Time Magazine's most influential Americans, Don Imus.
What the hell are you reading? What are you reading?
Mr. Imus, most recently on the cover of Newsweek, hails Bob as one of the major influences in his life and credits much of his success to the guidance and counsel of Mr. Cordero. Yeah. Bob has worked on municipal, county, and national government levels, and if he were not seeking the office of county commissioner, Bob would make a great president of the United States. Of this you can be certain, he would not have a fat intern honking on his love puppet in the Oval Office. Disgracing himself, the country, and the presidency.
Amen.
Please welcome to the Imus the Morning program, Bob Cordero.
His kids aren't clapping.
Did you make your kids wear these T-shirts?
No, believe it or not, I didn't have to.
Oh, you didn't?
No, they're into the effort.
They're very cute kids, all of them. And is that your wife?
Darling. Yes, that's my wife, Joy. Like,
look at the man the cross she bears.
The big one on the end.
And there's a big fat kid. Oh, that's Larry.
That's a kid we adopted.
Maybe we should talk to your oldest son. What's going on with
you?
Find out how things are in the
Now you be on your best behavior now, here.
Here now, Bob Cordero. Again, Bob's oldest son, is it Larry?
Larry.
Huh?
Yeah.
What kind of a parent is Bob?
Absent a lot.
Oh, yeah.
Well, apparently he has to travel with Aunt Trixie. They go places. They apparently work at hotels. They go to hotels.
And you like all your little brothers and sisters?
Yeah. Oh, they're okay.
No. And your mom, you like her?
No. I did until Dad told me some things about her.
What did Dad say about her?
She used to burn me with cigarettes. And she's a bitch, he said.
Well, thank you very much, Larry. Little Larry Cordero.
Now I'm just a bartender, and I don't like my work, but I don't mind the money at all. I see lots of sad faces and lots of bad cases of folks with their backs to the wall. And a honky
you need something new to talk about or something new to talk on, Nokia has an announcement.
Like to have sex and then marry the man she defraud. Degenerate broad, all the phony people. Where do they all come from? All the phony people. What do they all see done? Poor Robert Blakey got caught in Bonnie Lee's heinous paternity scheme. Went to the extreme, took her to dinner.
Them salad is just absurd.
It's just stupid. And then leaves them on.
And then leaves them on, and it's annoying. They're louder than the monitors.
Oh.
And you tell them three or four times, and you get this like a kid, and you finally say, there's got to be some consequences.
Right. And it does. It continues to happen over
but,
and over.
But the broadcasters,
again.
Tim McCarver and Joe Buck are here, and they wanted headphones in case Bedard says something or Lou
right.
icky about them. They'll hear it. So please welcome to the Imus Morning Program, the aforementioned Tim McCarver and Joe Buck.
Yelling all the time,
Pastor. Excuse me, James, the men were trying to talk here.
Yeah.
What are you saying? I said,
oh, Frank. Francesca doesn't yell.
Come in here, boy.
Mad Dog yells.
Broadcasters
yeah,
don't
dog
have yells. To yell.
Well, that's Mad Dog's deal.
At least it's important stuff that they're yelling
yeah.
about.
Yeah.
No. Yeah. That's fifth, Mike. Mike, he's a fifth place batter.
I disagree, totally.
Mike, look. Jimmy, let me explain. Did you or did you not say last game he was a fifth place batter?
Imus in the morning.
Oh, like, I don't want to hear about that. I want to hear about the last time you said he was a fifth place batter.
Little what I said, dog.
I almost drove into the bridge yesterday. I had no idea what he was screaming about. I'm a sports fan. I don't know what he's talking about.
Oh, boy, not right.
Imus in the morning. Sports Radio 66, WFAN.
The word is out. High-speed hot truck.
You're not wearing your seatbelt, right?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Well, did he know you were the cop?
No, I told him. I'd try to get off the
what
ticket.
What do you mean you told him?
What?
I can't ever do that. If they don't know, if they don't recognize, you got to just shut up.
You just have to take it.
You just have to take it. What did you say to him?
I'm Sid Rosenberg?
I said, listen, I'm on my way to work.
Yeah. I'm only a couple of blocks away. I took off the seatbelt. I was wearing it on the parkway. I took it off because I'm only a couple of blocks away.
No, he knew, so you lied. Right away, he knew you were lying.
Well, I'm sure he did. Yeah. He said, well, where do you work? I said, I work at FAN. I'm about to go on Don Imus' show.
Yeah.
I said, so maybe you could do the right thing and, you know.
Be a Stern fan. That's the first thing.
Well, he may have been because he didn't. He just kept writing the ticket.
First of all, don't be giving cops any lip anyway. Just shut up and take the ticket.
I mean,
and wear your seatbelt.
$85.
That's tough.
That's a lot of money for a ticket, don't you think?
No, if a cop pulls you over, just say, yes, sir, hand him your license and move on. No, don't be bad. Don't be fat-mouthing cops.
I didn't bad-mouth the cop. All I said was...
Don't say anything.
Just
say yes,
sir.
Yes. Just say yes, sir. Thank you.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
May I have another?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, officer.
Thank you for reminding me. I'll try to do better in the future.
Yes, sir.
Enjoy your coffee.
Imus in the Morning, 2020 Sports, with Sid, Osama Bin Rosenberg.
Good morning, Sid.
Hello, I-Man. Big night last night in the NBA playoffs. The New Jersey Nets, you thought they may wrap it up last night in Indiana against the Pacers? That would not be the case. The Nets blown out in Indiana last night, lost by 23 points.
Suck.
Well, they are the number one seed in the Eastern Conference.
How they doing?
They're tied 2-2.
Yeah, game five with an 8 seed.
It's true. And that'll be in New Jersey tomorrow night.
Pathetic.
Also last night in the NBA playoffs,
Charlotte. What was the deal with what was the guy with the socks, the black socks?
Is that Keith Van Horn you're talking about?
Jesus, God.
It is a bad look.
And by the way, does he get up and look at that hair and think, hey, this looks pretty good. I'll go with this.
I think I'll go.
Yeah. Hey, I got an idea. Why don't I go on TV with this hair? And these socks like this. He's retarded.
Well, he's not a good-looking guy. I'll give you that. Well, you know, he went to in school out in Utah, you know, with the Mormons.
Well, whatever he did.
Yeah. Well, I guess that's acceptable behavior out there. Outside of Park City, of course, but I guess in Salt Lake City, that's okay.
I guess.
Well, he's not the best-looking guy in the NBA, I'll give you that, but don't you remember when Rick Smits used to be the center for the Pacers? He used to wear his socks real high, I-Man, up above his knees?
No, I don't.
No? How high do you wear your socks when you go to the gym on a daily basis?
Down around my ankles.
You push them down, right?
Yeah. Yeah, because you don't want to... I mean, it affects the circulation in your legs. That's the first thing.
Too tight. Oh, I didn't even know that.
No.
Yeah. I just thought it looked stupid. Yeah.
It does look stupid. Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Right on both counts.
You go out and you buy those ankle socks, those tennis socks.
I wear my wife's socks, actually.
Really?
Yeah. Well, you know.
We have something in common. You wear your wife's socks, I wear my wife's underwear.
We know that. We found that out yesterday, but let's not move on here. What else? How do Islanders do?
Islanders lost. Islanders went down 4-2, and they lose the series in 7 games now.
Good.
So I thought Louis would be more depressed today. I was actually...
No, he's not in a good mood.
It really is because of the Islanders, you think?
Well, he hasn't said anything. Usually he's got a bunch of yucks. He says nothing as much.
He's got nothing, yeah.
Which is fine. I mean, he's entitled to be depressed.
And you know that if the Islanders won last night, he'd be walking in with his new New York Islanders t-shirt that he bought last week.
Yeah.
Like the decals are still sticky. It's such a new shirt.
Yeah.
You're supposed to take that shirt and rub it in the street for a couple of minutes. It looks like it's game worn. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Unless it's not your shirt, right?
No. Sid doesn't have any shirts that are his shirts. What else? Come on.
Also tonight, Boston and Philadelphia, a series that
could be a great game.
It should be a great game. All three games have been very good games, and the home team, of course, has won every game up to this point.
So this is in Boston tonight?
In Philadelphia.
What is in Philadelphia?
First two in Boston, I-Man. Next two in Boston, in Philadelphia, I should say. If the 76ers win tonight, they will return to Boston for a game 5.
What do you think will happen?
I think the Celtics wrap it up tonight. What do you think is going to happen?
It depends on how Iverson plays.
Let's say Iverson plays good.
Then the Sixers win.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
Then they go back to Boston, and Boston wins there.
Yeah, that's probably the way it's going to go down.
No.
That's a good job.
We need Boston. I mean, I'm not patronizing Boston.
No.
We need Boston to be the kind of franchise it used to be.
What, are you talking about the days of Larry Bird and Kevin McHale, or back to the days of Bill Russell when they won, you know, 10 championships?
I wouldn't mind that either.
Yeah.
But, I mean, we need them. You know, those used to be great. I'm not a Boston Celtics fan, by the way.
You're a Lakers fan.
Yeah. But I just like to see it. There's something about it.
They were a
parquet floor, I guess they tore up.
Yeah.
The institution of the Boston Celtics.
Dynasty.
Do you miss the old days of...
I like the fans in Boston because they're loyal.
They're loyal, of course.
I like
that
about them.
Do you miss the old days of the great teams in the NBA when the Sixers were great, the Lakers are great, the Celtics are great?
No,
they were great with Bill Buckner. They're loyal. They were great. Excellent fans.
Islanders. Hooray for them.
What was that Islander score again?
The guy had to move out of Boston.
What was the Islander score again?
Well, I don't... 4-2 Toronto.
Get fast, people.
Great Boston. I'm a
Whether you need something new to talk about or something...
For Whitman's Chocolate since 1842. With reports every 20 minutes, Rich Ackerman, WFAN, 2020 Sports.
Listen to our Saturday NFL doubleheader as the Vikings host the Dolphins, followed by the 49ers and Cardinals. Tomorrow, beginning at 1 p.m., exclusively on your flagship station for the NFL playoffs, starting January 4th. The Fan. Sports Radio 66, WFAN, New York.
Hey, folks, Sid Rosenberg here, and I'm about to say a word with them.
PLJ, part of the best variety of the 80s, 90s, and today. Now, before you go out and...
However, I did think Carolina could beat the 49ers.
And they did, 30-24, Green Bay over Denver, 41-6. You picked Denver in that game?
No, I picked...
Oh, you picked Green Bay.
Picked Green Bay, picked...
Pittsburgh over San Diego.
And Florida over Alabama.
Well, that was an easy, pretty easy pick.
Yeah. No, it wasn't a pretty easy pick, chump face. That was a great game. You know, I called you, and you. What were you watching? The Army-Navy game nobody cares about.
Army won, by the way, thank God, and that's because I resorted to prayer. And Army whooped Navy again, and they should have whooped him.
Yeah, it was an exciting
And the
game.
Reason Navy should have lost is because of the way they treat that poor field goal kicker that John Feinstein was telling us about.
That's right.
What's his name? Broccoli or Bean Cooley or something.
Yeah.
Broccoli. Well, you were the only person watching that game.
That was a great football game. Did you see that, Breen?
Yep.
That was
wasn't
a good game.
A football game.
Yeah. Pardon me?
That wasn't a football game.
You know, Fred...
Florida-Alabama was a football game.
We're not in the mood for your negativity this morning. we need a little more... Well, we want you to be more up here.
Yeah, I am up.
More positive and stuff.
We had enough down stuff.
Yeah, all right. Breen's going to do sports. Can
I'm trying to call now.
Pardon me?
Trying to dial in.
What?
I'm trying to dial. Get this thing to work.
You know what he's saying?
I have no idea.
He's God, he's just a moron. He's
Hey, and now Imus in the morning, 2020 sports with Mark Breen.
Jordan was fairly quiet scoring-wise, but there's Rodman. Rodman into the lane of Kukoc, and it's going to be a foul.
And a technical foul. Rodman's out of the game.
Chicago Bulls are falling apart. Good morning. Mike Breen with Sports. Mike Inglis, voice of the Raptors with a call. As one NBA player once said, the ship be sinking. Chicago Bulls are in turmoil, suffered their second loss in as many nights. Raptors beat them in Toronto 97-89. Jordan and Rodman hit with key technical fouls. And the Bulls are now tired of Rodman. Listen to Scottie Pippen on Dennis Rodman.
His game is, especially after, you know, really conduct himself a little bit better on the court. I mean, every time the horse is blown, he's chasing the ball, he's doing something with it. And I mean, it builds up frustration within his teammates. So you can imagine how the officials feel. I mean, they can't stand there and watch him every play.
Here it starts. Now listen to Phil Jackson and his take on the game.
The game really was taken out of our hands by the referees.
Now they're starting to blame the referees on their losses. Even guard Steve Kerr ripped Jordan for his ball hogging.
He's a jerk.
The fall is officially underway. Chicago Bulls' third loss of the season. Also losing last night, the L.A. Clippers lost
you know,
Cleveland.
Between you and my brother, I mean, there's not a brain between the two of you.
You know, everyone's afraid to go after the Bulls, everyone but me. Mm-hmm. I know the real deal.
They lost three games.
That's right.
Doofus lips.
Two in two nights. Bald-headed stooge.
Drainpipe neck. Howdy-doody-looking jackass.
They lost to Cleveland to the Cavs 90-69. Coach Bill Fitch talked about the loss. And he also talked about the Imus in the Morning program with NBA reporter John Minko.
Are you aware that Imus has inked a new 7-year contract to stay on the radio?
You mean Fred Imus. What did they give Don? Did they give Don anything?
Coach Fitch will be appearing at Chuckles this weekend.
Are you there, friend?
Larney
Stone. Yes, I am.
Thank you for all your participation this morning. Another dismal performance by my brother. Oh, no, here he is, Chuck. Check this out.
Ho, ho, ho.
God almighty.
Ho, ho, ho. Santa needs a ho. Ho, ho, ho. Yeah. Ho, ho.
My brother appearing this morning on MSNBC on the audiophone in a Santa hat.
Ho, ho, ho. Santa needs a ho, ho,
I know,
ho.
I know, we get it. Say it again, friend.
Yeah, Lord,
say it again,
sit
friend.
On Santa's lap and make a wish. You want to see Santa's candy cane?
This is a real challenge now for Fred to come up with something visual for the 200 people watching MSNBC. God. What do you like in tonight's game, Fred?
I like the Raiders tonight.
That game's in Oakland?
Well, who cares where it is? Yes, it is in Oakland. What difference does it make where it is?
The Oakland Raiders play Kansas City.
And it's really easy to take them seriously, too, for crying out loud.
Jeez. God, you're such an...
Ho, ho, ho.
You know, you're such an...
Ho, ho, ho. Dear, ho, 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 ho.
Your sister-in-law is so humiliated by you. I mean, David loves Fred, but...
What have I done wrong? Have I done something stupid?
Oh, I mean, no. Sometimes she'll just say to me, is this necessary?
I married white trash.
I said, yeah, you did, honey.
White trash. She married into a family of white trash.
Poor thing. She's over there studying at the sore bone, thinking, man, I'm...
Sore bone, yes, but Santa's got a sore bone.
God almighty.
Santa's got him a sore bone.
That will be fine.
Hey, Bubba, what are you doing? Signing another bill? Like, you don't have to now. You got reelected.
No, I'm checking off my Christmas list. Let's see, I got Roger a Buzz Lightyear.
He's already got a light buzz on all year. What about everybody else?
I'm going to send folks stuff out of the Fred Imus catalog. Got Jim and Susan McDougal an auto body express calendar.
So they can check off the days until the pardon?
Yeah, at least that's what I'll tell them. I'll get Hillary one of them prairie-style buffalo skirts.
If they fit a buffalo, they should fit her.
Well, they are one size fits all.
The way her legs looked in that picture from Australia, it'll probably fit her like a miniskirt.
Chelsea gets a four-legged Fred t-shirt.
But she might think Rush Limbaugh sent it to her.
Good point. I'll go with the denim vest instead. Sure looks good on Deirdre there, don't it? Boy, she makes my knees knock.
Careful, Bubba. You put moves on the eye woman, you can end up having to sit through another one of those speeches from hell.
Well, that's why I'm ordering all this stuff out of the ABX catalog, babies.
To get the eye man to lay off you a little bit?
No, to get the eye woman to lay on me a little bit.
On the first day of Christmas, Fred Imus sent to me 7 ounce cotton t-shirts, 62,370 stitches on the New Mexico and Texas jackets, 5 golden buffalo chips, 4 corner flannels, 3 bandana ties, 2 jars of hot stuff, and the blow-up doll from MSNBC.
Among your papers in your briefcase? What's the last time you ran into it before you said I do, or is it hanging out with the dust bunnies behind the couch? Well,
it's 8 minutes past the hour.
And now we continue with a Hallmark Hall of Fame special presentation. Charles Dickens' immortal A Christmas Carol, the story of Ebenezer Imus. When last we left Ebenezer Imus, the man who hated Christmas, he had just electrocuted dear Bernie Cratchit, his faithful employee who had dared besiege Ebenezer for a half hour off on Christmas. Once home, Ebenezer Imus took some gruel, sat with his miserable cat in his dismal room, checked C-SPAN for any late ethics hearings, and finding none, got into bed. Directly, carolers stopped by beneath his window to spread some cheer. A big mistake.
Hey, what's going on down there? Hey, get away from here. Oh, you want something for making your fruit music?
I got a little something for you.
And with that, the meanest, most despicable man in the village threw the contents of his bedchamber down upon them.
There, a little shit. That'll hold you bastards.
Later, as Christmas Eve slipped into Christmas morning, something odd happened. Something most disagreeable. Ebenezer Imus awoke with a start.
What? Who's there? Who is it? Answer me.
Good morning, Mr. Imus.
What?
I'm the ghost of Christmas past. Remember, you used to date me.
Yeah, but you're just a bacon-eyed bimbette. I mean, who are you?
Well, actually, I'm just a composite of all your past dates, you know?
Yeah.
22, perky breakfast model with yogurt for brains.
Oh, yeah.
And if you don't change your ways, I'm coming back to haunt you for the rest of your days.
Oh, Jesus, no, please, not that again.
And in a swirl of chiffon, the ghost of Christmas past was gone. But no sooner had Ebenezer Imus lay down again and closed his eyes.
Damn, I could have broke my neck. Hey, Ebenezer Imus, get up, boy.
What the hell is going on here? Who the f*** are you?
I'm Big Feet, the ghost of Christmas present, my man.
Huh?
The Christmas blues you be spreading at the Barnard Cratchit domicile. I was going to have to take you over there and show you how you bumming them out. Let's go.
And with that, he snatched up Ebenezer's hand and flew with him through the window.
All right. Look down there, Ebenezer Imus. That's a Cratchit household.
Yeah, I see that. There's Bernie and the frail little crippled boy, Small Paul.
Tiny Tim ain't Small Paul.
I don't know how they can be all so happy. I mean, I give Cratchit first-degree burns over 65% of his body. And look at that. They're drinking a toast to me.
That's right, Slice. They forgive you for what you done.
Wow.
But I don't.
Uh-oh.
If you change your ways, promise to send Tiny Tim Cratchit to college, or what the next spell's gonna show you is what's gonna come a pass. Stay black, baby.
Oh, hey, wait a minute. What's coming? What's next, Spirit? Hey!
But there was no reply. Just a lonesome harmonica riff fading in the distance. Ebenezer Imus found himself back in his room, but not entirely alone.
Ebenezer! Ebenezer Imus! Arise and follow me!
Hey, wait a minute!
Argue not!
Okay, I'm right with you.
You've seen Christmas past and present.
Yeah.
Now, this is what lies ahead for you if you fail to get a perspective. Behold.
Wait a minute. It's my radio station. There's a dwarf sitting in my chair.
Listen, Ebenezer Imus.
7:45, quarter till 8 here on the Lupica in the Morning Show.
What?
Time again for Chris Berman with sports. Chris, love that outfit, man. My side.
Lupica in the morning? But that little jerk's never funny.
You're telling me. Yet that's your future, Ebenezer Imus, if you fail the Cratchits, especially Tiny Tim.
Well, next day, Christmas, it seemed quite a different Ebenezer Imus, who bounded from his bed and threw open the window, calling out to all who could hear.
Merry Xmas! Merry Xmas, everybody!
And with all the speed he could muster, he ran headlong to the home of Bernie Cratchit, pounding on the door of the startled family within.
Cratchit! Cratchit, open up! It's Ebenezer Imus!
Mr. Imus, what in the world?
May I come in?
Why, of course, sir. Of course, we'd be honored.
And with that, dear reader, Ebenezer Imus, face beaming, strode into the parlor of Bernie Cratchit and kicked the crutch out from under Tiny Tim.
Now, you little creep, screw up my life, will you?
God bless us, everyone. Miracle on 34th Street? It's Imus. I don't think so.
We'll be right back.
like to welcome Rabbi Mark Gelman and Monsignor Tom Hartman. How are you guys?
Doing great.
Do you still have that hideous cable show you were doing? The God Squad?
Hideous.
Are these all real questions?
Yeah, they really are. Yeah. And Maya Angelou called and she said...
We like Maya Angelou.
Right, yeah. Yeah.
You ever heard Bernard do Maya Angelou?
We have.
Okay, he's not going to do it now.
No, please, Bernard, please.
Let me get a cigarette.
No. If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the morning.
It'll be the first television program teaching children about the religions of the world. And they animated Tommy, they animated me. And they said, look, he has a large nose, okay? It's not that large.
No, it's not.
It's not that large, and we want you to change the animation. That's the way it is. You know, we now have a priest who looks, you know, like Robert Redford, and we have a rabbi who...
Looks like Joe Camel.
Who looks like Joe Camel.
What does it take to make the perfect martini? Crystal clear ice, extra dry vermouth, a bartender with impeccable shaking style, and Grey Goose vodka. Imported from France, Grey Goose vodka is the best...
Fine issues of the day. From the hood, Imus in Washington, Snoop Doggy Dog.
Snoop Doggy Claws, and I'm good to go. I'm fat and I'm jolly and I got plenty of snow. Know what I'm saying? Well, it's Christmas time in the hood. Time to get in the spirit of peace on earth. Goodwill toward all white men. Another year gone, and the brothers ain't any further along in the struggle than we've been before. So I don't want no fat dude coming down my chimney unless he got my civil rights in that bag of his. How come this boy be busting people's houses all over the world, but ain't nobody never nailed him for breaking and entering? Why is Santa Claus white? Why can't he be black? Instead of cruising in a sleigh, he'd have a hoopty Cadillac. I guess if a brother was in your house holding a sack, you'd wait till he turned around so you could shoot him in the back. What's my name? Oh, dear, you shot Santa. It was self-defense, Margaret. Here, quick, put this gun in his hand. Ho, ho, ho. Yo, yo, yo. Got a little gift for all of you dudes at Texaco. To show you Snoop Doggy Claws know what Christmas means, I'm filling up your stockings with black jelly beans. What's my name?
Snoop Doggy Claws.
Oh, yeah, those are jelly beans. I don't mind that rabbit that just crawled out of there. A benevolent Christmas is what I'm dreaming of. Full of harmony, peace, brotherhood, and one love. So this holiday season, as you raise in your glass, be thankful Santa doesn't bust a cap in your ass. What's my name?
Snoop Doggy.
Uh-huh. Remember the reason for the season.
Snoop Doggy.
And that Jesus started out poor, homeless, and discriminated against. Discriminated. You know, they was dissing him, too.
So I don't let them make me feel guilty about it. I just say I have other plans, and then I have other plans.
Absolutely. My other plans involve staying away from here.
Yeah. I've never been in any sort of situation where it wasn't a tension convention. And where it didn't degenerate into some hideous argument.
And you
and so Larry just was so exasperated with me yesterday, claiming... And Larry, I guarantee you, in any sort of holiday situation, I'd be the first person to blow up and storm out of the house.
Absolutely.
And go downtown to the bar. I guarantee it.
You just hear four doors slam and the last one is going out.
Absolutely. Larry would be the first one to lose it.
Punch somebody out.
Exactly. So I just refuse. I just don't go to anybody's
Sling
house.
Drink a
glass. I have been to Fred's for Thanksgiving and Christmas, and it's pleasant because Fred doesn't say anything to you.
Yeah.
And I would go to Charles's house for Thanksgiving.
Although maybe we'll see you there.
But I'm not invited, so.
No, you're not.
But that's fine. So,
the operative word there is you would go.
So Larry says, I like Christmas. I don't want to hear depressing Christmas songs. And Santa Can't Stay is best I could tell, the best I could hear it. It's about a guy who, I guess the husband and wife are estranged or something. And he shows up drunk and throws a present at the kid.
Well, you get it on now.
That's what I'm supposed
to do. Cut it up, Lou.
Cut 10. We'll get to the news here in a minute. Don't worry about it. There's nothing going on. Tom Aspel's in Baghdad. We're going to talk to him.
All right.
There's nothing else going on. But there's a few things, but we'll tell you. Cut 10 on the Christmas album. It's called Santa Can't Stay. Well, let's listen to it. Here we go. Dwight Yoakam. Come on, Christmas.
threw a present really hard.
They both heard him come and saw Mom run down the hall and holler, "Wait, Doug, you're drunk. Don't come inside. I'm not joking. I've had all this I can take." He threw a present really hard that almost hit Mom's new boyfriend, Ray, and yelled, "Ho, ho, lucky for you, she's here," and said that Santa can't stay.
You're drunk. Warm.
Get out of here, you son of a bitch.
Lose the Santa. That Santa hat and the beard.
Oh, man, come on.
Oh, man.
I just love that. So, anyway, he's got some other, and he's got some serious stuff on here, too. It's just great stuff. Anyway, Dwight Yoakam and Kinky. So, Larry's just so irritated with me. He said, "Well, I don't want to hear that kind of Christmas song."
That's because you have a miserable experience.
I haven't ever had any real. That's what Larry said. Well, you must have had a horrible experience as a child. I said, "No, I haven't. But I've been in situations where it's degenerated into an ugly situation, and I'm not going to get involved in them. I just refuse to do it."
Joy to the world? I don't think so.
And families get together. Here's the thing, and you have to be honest about it.
There are members of your family, everybody on this planet, who you would never speak to if they weren't members of your family. There are people you'd hang out with. They would be friends of yours. You only talk to them, and you only know them because they're members of your family. That's a...
Ken.
That's all it is.
Ken.
And anybody who denies that is just simply lying. You know, that's all.
Oh, man.
No.
You're drunk.
That's what I've always liked about Fred. Fred is somebody who I would like anyway, whether I was related to him or not, you know? So yeah. I mean, that's the way the rest of them, it doesn't mean you don't love them. We're not talking about that.
Just don't want to hang out.
I'm just not going to hang out with them. You know? And I don't.
So. Draw names for presents. Oh, look, I have Sissy's name this year.
Well, that doesn't happen around my house. And look at Bernard again. And Bernard's probably worse than I am.
Absolutely not. You're just projecting your own miserable past onto
everybody else. No, I'm not. Believe me, there are a million people around this country sitting by the radio going, you know, he's absolutely right. And I am absolutely right. There are more horrible incidents involving families during Thanksgiving and Christmas than any other time of the year, mainly because they're all together.
Yeah, and depressed and killing themselves.
There are more suicides during the holidays than any other time of the year. And why? Because it's a nightmare.
Because they got to go see Aunt Jean.
You know, and everybody shows up at somebody's house, and the women get in the kitchen, they do all the cooking, get a bunch of fat drunken watching the Lions play football.
Falling asleep
there, or they're unbuttoned with their pants unbuttoned because they're so full.
The American way.
And then it's just it's a nightmare. But not for me, though, because I don't get involved in it. I won't go. And when somebody asks me, it's insulting.
Who would ask you?
Oh, a lot of people do. Well, they don't anymore because they know I won't go.
So, you know the deal.
So they save themselves.
It's like behavior.
And it isn't that they want me to go, by the way.
Of course not.
Absolutely not. Or it isn't that when people invite various members of their family, they don't want them there. They feel some idiotic obligation because the Hallmark Card Corporation has made them think this way.
Oh, man. Isn't it? What a jaded...
Absolutely. Man... The honesty's too much.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, you just can't deal with it. You don't want to hear the truth.
No, I can't wait for Chris. I love it.
Well, okay. There are obviously people who have good... Well, I have good experiences. Most of the time, we're at Fred's, and it's a great Christmas. So I agree. But you just have to be selective. You can't get involved with a bunch of people who you never see any other time of the year. And think that you're going to have a... It's just there's nothing to talk about. You don't really like them.
Nothing in common. Zero.
It may not even be. You may like them. That may not be true.
Couple of pops, everybody gets along.
No, they don't. See, that's the point. They don't.
A couple of pops, and somebody's pulling a gun.
And it's always people like you or Larry Kinney who express this outrage at me for being so cynical and jaded who have the absolute worst times. Particularly Larry. Larry's got a fuse like that.
I know.
Larry will blow. He was in here yesterday. He was steamed about something yesterday, wasn't he? Yeah. Then he was just. And then I'm in there playing Dwight Yoakam, and he's angry. And you know he loves Dwight Yoakam. But he's got so upset at this Santa can't stay. And I played it again. I played it. And I turned it down to the jukebox. You know, I just pumped it up as loud as just so the walls are shaking in there. You know.
Sleigh bells ring. Are you listening? In the lane, snow is glistening. A beautiful sight, we're happy tonight. Walking in a winter wonderland.
Imus in the morning.
Need to tell you about the Oral-B 3D XL Power Toothbrush, and I'm telling you, you feel like you just left the dentist.
Brown, a major bombshell announcement into the debate over the issue of abortion. Norma McCorvey, the woman whose request for an abortion led to the 1973 Roe versus Wade decision.
Speaking of drug addicts.
Exactly.
You know, has
been baptized by the leader of Operation Rescue and has joined the anti-abortion group.
I don't want to be, to sound like Bernard, but I saw them baptizing her in somebody's swimming pool yesterday. And
they didn't hold their head on the long enough.
Lord.
And I forget which news. I watched all three newscasts, and I don't know who. It could have been a Rather or Broca, one of them. But they pointed out that that the people, the fundamentalist Christians who baptized her had not yet asked her to dissolve her lesbian relationship.
Mm-hmm.
But when they pointed out that she was a lesbian, I just thought,
She looks like Marty Allen. Right, of course she's a lesbian.
She does look good.
But I mean, she doesn't need about worry about any abortions.
I mean, I know that's just a...
That's
well,
horrible.
It's
horrible.
Yeah. It reduces this program to the level of Howard Stern and Rush Limbaugh, yeah. But which doesn't mean it's not amusing. But some nitwit was listening to the best of Imus, and the Cardinal was on. Yeah. Then I guess he thought he won. $40 million.
Yeah. Sorry.
Didn't work, Rodrigo. Go back to the Dominican Republic.
I quit my job.
He calls up, tells him, boss the shoving. He quit all this stuff. He listened to the best of Imus this morning, and here's the Cardinal, and thinks he won.
I don't need no stinking job.
Take his job and stick it. So that's my favorite.
I love that.
So we're going to be gone. I'm going to Santa Fe today, and I'm in Charles going to Missouri or someplace.
Get out.
But the best of Imus in the morning is I listen to it, and I like it, so whether you do or not, but it's good. Because you don't have to listen to me read Maureen Dowd columns, for example. The Maureen Dowd column reading will not make the best of Imus in the morning.
No, that's on the...
Which makes you wonder why I would do it then in the first place. Except that I thought it was startling.
It's fascinating stuff. I mean, to be truthful, absolutely compelling, mesmerizing.
Breath of fresh air on the op-ed page of the Pennywaist New York Times.
Absolutely, yeah.
There you go.
So, what's your position on Jerry Garcia, Bernard?
I have to mega dittos to the fat man.
Just another fat.
Of course.
Another fat dead drug addict.
Glorify a fat heroin addict. Oh, that's great. Let's have a vigil for him in the park for a junkie.
Well, is that what you're going to say when I croak?
Oh, no, I'll be too hungover. I'll be too drunk. I'll be on heroin myself when you go.
On the first day of Christmas, my producer gave to me the Partridge Family. On the second day of Christmas, my producer gave to me two live crew and the Partridge Family. On the third day of Christmas, my producer gave to me three dog night, two live crew, and the Partridge Family. On the fourth day of Christmas, my producer gave to me the Four Seasons Sherry, three dog night, two live crew, and the Partridge Family. On the fifth day of Christmas, my producer gave to me the Jackson 5. Four Seasons Sherry, three dog night, two live crew, and the Partridge Family. On the, what are we up to now? Sixth? Oh, yeah. 16 tons, the Jackson 5. Four Seasons Sherry, three dog night, two live crew, and the Partridge Family. Where am I going to put all this stuff? What, seven? Oh, yeah, the Chicago 7, 16 tons, the Jackson 5. Four Seasons Sherry, three dog night, two live crew, and the Partridge Family. On the eighth day of Christmas, my producer gave to me 8 days a week. Oh, no, I lost my place. The Jackson 5. Four Seasons Sherry, three dog night, two live crew, and the Partridge Family. On the ninth day of Christmas, my producer gave to me the Stones 19th Nervous Breakdown. 8 days a week, the Chicago 7, 16 tons, the Jackson 5. Four Seasons Sherry, three dog night, two live crew, and the Partridge Family. Got another Camel, Fats? On the 10th day of Christmas, my producer gave to me 10 lids of Hawaiian. And, that's some good sh, you know. Trying to remember what else he gave me. It was a whole bunch of other hoopy dookies. Man, could I go for a pizza?
Scott Muni with the 12 Days of Christmas. Over from the Archdiocese. Good morning, Cardinal.
How are you looking at? Good morning, God bless. It's great to be out here in San Jose, Imus and Amar, sitting in the shark tank.
Yeah?
Next to the human eel, be Jesus. sitting next to a man who has more wrinkles than San Jose has wetbacks, be Jesus. I tell you that, just smut you.
That will be fine.
How about knowing nobody expressed ski master that gravity challenge pussy of yours, be Jesus? You're making me sick. The Fantasy Five numbers, I, Mr. Mark.
Yeah?
Fantasy Five sounds like an all right NBA team, I tell you that, Mr. Mark.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Speaking of football, Imus in the Morning, news from the Boston Archdiocese.
Okay.
Has it that Congressman Barney Frank has put in a bid to buy the beleaguered New England Patriots?
Well, yes.
He found out they have one good tight end and 21 guys who suck, be Jesus.
Imus in the Morning.
Associates of Westport publishers.
There ain't going to be no shenanigans here. This is going to be straight to my Christmas message.
All right.
I ain't some kind of prevert, all right?
Fine.
This'll be just flat out straight.
Fine, Mr. Brimley.
All right.
Quaker Oats Oatmeal Santa message, take one.
I'm Wilford Brimley for Quaker Oats Oatmeal. You know, when I was a kid growing up, me and all the other kids down the road used to get pretty excited come Christmas time, just like you do. To make sure old Santa Claus came to all our houses, why, we'd set out cookies and milk for him. The way we figured it was the right thing to do. But you know what? It wasn't. No, sir, because Santa Claus is an elderly man. He's way overweight, he smokes, and has cholesterol clogging up his arteries, and, well, we was just clogging him up worse. It wasn't the right thing to do. So this Christmas, instead of high-fat milk and cookies, you kids do the right thing. Set out a bowl of steaming oatmeal for Santa. It'll taste good, it'll warm him up, and bring Santa's cholesterol down. And it'll allow you to give him a present for a change, a big old boner.
No.
And that's a bonus for you, believe me.
No, for God's sake, Mr. Brimley.
Huh?
This is your Christmas spot.
I know that.
Well, are you a f***ing lunatic?
Hey, sonny, you just watch how you talk to old people,
well,
huh?
You can't say boner to these kids.
Now, there's a damn lie. Do I make the oatmeal?
Well,
no, sir. Quaker Oats makes oatmeal and boners. And kids, you're going to be glad they do when Santa, who after all is 1,000 years old or something, thanks you for giving him an oatmeal boner.
No, he won't.
You think you got a nifty train set last year? How'd you like Amtrak?
No.
Huh? Did you like that jet plane? How'd you like to own the Trump shuttle? Well, that just might be the way that old Santa Claus is going to say, Johnny, thanks for the boner.
No,
yes, sir, you'll sneak downstairs and there you'll be. Twinkle in his eye, trousers down around his ankles, and his little round belly shaking like a bowl full of oatmeal. Because he's under the Christmas tree f***ing your oatmeal. Saying, on Dancer, on Dasher, on Donner and Blitzen, I finally got me the boner I've been missing. And then if you listen real close, you'll hear him exclaim ere he flies out of sight, the toys, more oatmeal. It's a hell of a night. Yes, sir. It's the right thing to do. Ho, ho, ho.
Attention in there.
On the fourth day of Christmas, Lou returned the compliment.
Yeah. Die! 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 Die!
No. On the fifth day of Christmas, all hell breaks loose.
Die!
Who the hell cares?
Die! Die! Die!
Well, press the damn button.
Die!
Don't be calling me.
Die! Die! Die!
What's the problem in there?
On the sixth day of Christmas, I'm in Braxtonby. On the seventh day of Christmas, the IMS is wrong.
I'm gonna take this and shove it right into your arm. The eighth day of Christmas, the IMS said to me, send out Christmas cards to all of the people I know.
On the ninth day of Christmas, Angela says to me,
550 names in here, and I'm supposed to get these cards out by 10?
On the tenth day of Christmas, the IMS is free.
Good work, Bernie.
Shut up, you jerk.
jerk.
On the 12th day of Christmas, the Amen said to me.
Tell you one thing I'll do. I'll come in there and take you two white boys and knock your point little heads together. That's what I do.
Come on, brother.
The Amen said to me.
So you get that, baby, and have a merry Xmas.
Fresh like Santa, you have to say ho, ho, ho. So girls and boys, let's make some noise. Give thanks for joys and all goodies and toys. For Christmas, yes indeed, this must be the greatest holiday treat. So people just bust, I'll celebrate as we elevate. Big Daddy Kane is on the mic and I'ma tell a great Christmas line for your delight. Just Merry Christmas to all and to all a good night.
Christmas in the morning. Yeah.
No problemo.
The Steinway stop. Hang on, brother.
The Steinway and Walker Block.
Hang on, brother. Hang on, brother.
Take the last car in the subway. It's easier.
Rush Limbaugh, he's coming up here on the Imus in the Morning program, and so is Beavis and Bubba. Now, Breen, where's Breen? Get Breen in here.
Yeah, where is that geek?
Breen is, Breen, me and Charles are going out to the U.S. Open today. And tomorrow night, Deirdre and I are going to go. And then on Thursday, I'm taking Larry Kenny and Rob Bartlett, the two fat boys.
Yeah. The bookend brothers. Oh, man.
It's like going to church with your grandmother. You really don't want to go.
Breen, you understand what the situation is today, don't you?
I'm beginning to think I'm not going.
Why?
Because I'm not going to go get you your nachos and your bottled water all day.
Yes, you are.
That's not my role.
Well, that is your role.
Sure, it's a support role here.
Charles and I will be sitting there trying to enjoy the tennis matches, and you will be going out, standing on line, getting the stuff for us, and then waiting there in the little alleyway while during the changeover, and hopefully there'll be like a 20-minute tiebreak.
Just a mob standing there.
Yeah. Give me a couple $100 to get your lunch, and I'll go get it, and then return.
And you will bring us our stuff. You'll do as you're told to do.
Young man.
Is that what you're wearing?
Yes, it is. I wore it specially for you today. Little shorts.
You're wearing shorts and a polo shirt.
So he's one of the geeks who dresses in tennis attire.
I don't quite look as handsome as you in your denim jacket. 90-degree weather.
Yeah, I'm a Cinnamoni. In your shorts, 2020 sports.
Double play. Game is over. Yankees lose.
Familiar words from the Bronx. Good morning. Mike the Bee with sports. John Sterling with the call. Wow. Yankees drop
what?
Mike the Bee.
What's wrong with Mike Breen?
I want to have a little...
I know we've been through what you want to have, but...
I like Murray the K, you had a big career. Mike the B.
Mike the B.
Mike the B.
I like that.
Yeah, great.
Billy Taylor calls himself the BT Express, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. It should be the BD Express, the Brain Dead Express. Billy Taylor. We got to have... Next time you're off, we have to have Billy Taylor back, you know?
It's time for a Billy
Taylor. For a Billy Taylor fix.
Yankees drop a 4-3 decision to the Royals. Russ Davis of the Yanks knows what needs to be done.
You know, it's just time to turn it up a notch and see what we can do.
Now it's time to turn it up a notch. Yeah, how about 2 weeks ago when you were still in a pennant race?
15 or 16 and a half games out.
Idiot.
So. The veteran running back from the Carolina Panthers, Barry Foster, they expected great things. He was cut yesterday. Led the AFC in rushing just a couple of years ago, but he's been injured. And his teammate Tim McKeyer says that always spells trouble.
One of my mottos is you can't make the club in the tub.
What are some of his other mottos?
Can we get away and get a list of those?
You sound like a whack if you do enough crack.
Can't make the club if you spend it in the tub. Rubber dub dub and your mug. Jesus, God, shut up.
Get on the team in the dream.
You get your haul, you get the ball.
This last of my class don't make me no ass. You know what I'm saying?
Can't drink gin and win.
Hammer time.
Yeah, that's the thing.
I'd like how a fool if I don't go to school.
Yeah. You gotta
God
go
almighty.
So much fun.
Jesus.
Get out of here.
Just say no. Of course, the NFL coming up this weekend. First round of games on Sunday, and then the big Monday night game, Giants and Cowboys at Giants Stadium. Right,
for those of you with DirecTV, you can watch the, or if you just happen to be in these cities, in either Philadelphia or Tampa, Breen is doing the Eagles-Buccaneers game, right?
From Veterans Stadium in Philadelphia.
So...
I ain't no ready, but I hate waiting. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, I think we do. I'd like to welcome Tyrone McCartney of the Black Beetle, right?
That's right. Uh-huh. You got it.
I got that right, didn't I?
You did.
So, happy Merry Christmas, Tyrone.
And happy Merry Christmas to you, too, Mr. Imus.
So you guys got anything special planned?
Matter of fact, it's funny you should say that.
We happen to have a brand new Fabulous Black Beatles holiday album.
I'll be darned.
The Black Beatles, I'm Dreaming of a Black Christmas.
Uh-huh.
Well, you can hear some of them all-time favorite Christmas carols, like this one here.
Right.
Rudolph the Rapping Reindeer had a shiny new beatbox. And if you heard him get down, you would know the bad boy rocks. And how about this one?
Yeah.
Sleigh bells ring, it's the season, and the weather is pleasing. It's snowing tonight, what a beautiful sight on Adam Clayton Power Boulevard. And how about this one?
Right.
You better watch out, you better not pucker, you better not pout, he's a bad mother. Santa Claus is coming uptown.
We're gonna have a little trouble with that one.
No, I don't think you will.
Uh-huh.
And of course, my personal favorite.
Yeah.
On the 12th day of Christmas, my bitch gave in to me 12 Subway tokens, 11 Coupe de Villes, 10 packs of Cools, 9 pairs of Adidas, 8 dudes are singing, 7 homeboys chilling, 6 pack of Millers, 5 golden chains, 4 McDLTs, 3 French fries, 2 Kangol caps, and a ticket for Run DMC. Merry Christmas.
I'm Derek Cope.
CBS FM, there they are, the cast of Friends. Staying alive into their 10th season on television, I hear. Another $1 million per episode to help that staff stay alive. Congratulations. All right, reindeer.
Voice
Radio 66, WFA.
Now time for the Giants' turning point of the game contest from J.P. Morgan Chase. If you were listening to yesterday's Giants postgame show, then you heard the turning point of the game. First call to correctly identify it at 1-800-821-6611 wins a handsome Croton watch valued at $250. 527 on the fan. Jody Mack in for Mike and the Dog. We'll go to 630 tonight. Thanks to Jim Fossil for hopping on. Fan Jody Mack from Mike and the Dog. Dick from Corona, how are you?
How are you, my friend? I'm not going to use...
It's 42 degrees under clear skies, and that's what's happening. I'm Bob Uessler with 2020 Sports on WFAN, the flagship station of the Imus in the Morning program, weekday mornings from 5:30 until 10.
When people hear WFAN New York...
After 6 here on the fan, Jody Mack in for Mike and the Mad Dog. We'll get a bunch of phone calls in here. We're taking you up to Ranger hockey tonight on the fan. Rangers Devils, good one, as we make it through the holiday season. 718-937-6666 is our number. Oh, here's my buddy, a couple buddies on the line. Marvin from Brooklyn's on the fan. Hello, Marvin.
Jody, I want to say one thing to begin with. God bless you. God bless Miriam. She's terrific. And God bless all the people out there except the terrorists, you know.
Appreciate that.
When some of his anecdotes include players that are still living, of course. Nice.
That
was nice.
Yeah. Warner has a speaking role in one of his movies.
Yes, I heard all about it, yes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. He'll be up for an Academy Award, I'm sure.
Now, what is this invitation you have?
Well, I came in this morning, and I found this in my box. I know nothing about it. Maybe you want to read it. I don't know.
It says it has a picture of a bottle of champagne with a cork coming out of
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
And it says, Bernie, Lou, and Charles invites you to come say Bimus to Imus. Drinks at 9. And it reads, he's heading out far west to help the kids with cancer. He's leaving New York City, this jolly old rancher. It's 3 months of freedom. If he stays the course, it could be even more. Pray there's one good horse. That is not good. Oh no, he's falling again. Another awful spill. He's sliding on his head down the steepest hill. But that's not really funny. We really wish him well. Give him one good time before he goes to hell. So, I, man, love your trip. We all wish you goodbye. 3 months is long enough. There's a chance you'll die.
Oh, my God.
Wow. But if that's not the case, believe us, we won't weep. It's just a matter of time before you're 6 feet deep. Who wrote this? You, Lou?
No, me. I wish I had written it.
You wish you'd written it?
The guy's talented. He's got the iambic pentameter down.
Yeah.
Jack Frost.
Yeah. Drinks at 9 tomorrow night, so.
That is ugly. Wishing me dead, I think it's bad karma.
That's awful. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely terrible. I just got the invitation. I know nothing about it, I mean, but I'm RSVPing, yes.
When I'm no longer here, I want all of you to go try telling Chernoff and Lita stick it and see how far that goes.
Right. Probably won't go very far.
See how that works out for you.
Well, you guys, good luck.
There you go, Sid. It's not that funny.
Yeah, where are you going to be?
Oh, me?
Yeah, you.
Yeah, you.
I forget it.
Back to the sports guys.
You're making bagels.
Back with the Giants fans.
Yes.
You're driving Rich Ackerman to work.
I said we missed you, Sid.
Is Rich married, by the way, Ackerman?
No.
Oh, he's got tons of babes.
Well, he's not a bad-looking guy.
No.
But he still is with his mom.
Oh, my God.
Oh, Jesus, this is a David Berkowitz right in the making.
Just picked up his laundry, I think. Mom, did you do the whites well? He's going to kill me.
Maybe we should let Rich do an update here this morning.
I think that is the best idea I've heard all day.
Sure, really something to do, does he have enough time to get prepared?
He quit at 2 this morning.
What is today, Thursday? He had to come in on Monday.
Needs a three-day weekend, probably.
As it is, he was up at 3 this morning ironing his shirt. I got to get ready to leave. I have to leave. I have to get here at 7. Oh, my God, I got to get on 10.
See, if Benigno goes on at 12 midnight, I'll...
The night before, he's laying out his socks and he...
For the next 3 days.
Unfolding his underwear and he jumped in.
Beeper.
Yeah.
Get the cleaning stuff for the phone.
I got to get ready.
I don't know.
Oh, God. Oh. I'm ready to go.
Oh, boy.
Only 9 hours. I don't dare sleep.
What does he do when he's off? Does he still hang around?
He gets ready to come.
He gets
back.
Ready to come here. Sure, exactly.
He called the newsroom.
Huh?
He called the newsroom.
He does?
I picked up the phone and it's been him on his day off. How are you?
So just checking in, see if I'm needed.
I'm looking for Eric.
For what?
They might be breaking.
I don't get into it with him. I say, hey, Rich, how you doing?
He loves his work, I mean.
Nice day outside, isn't it? You should go look at it.
Well, that's good. I mean, that's
a good man. He's a good man.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
Knows his sports.
All right, what happened with... speaking of that...
By the way, with the Nets.
Let me just... How about the Nets owners talking to the Boston Celtics owners and saying, hey,
Jumana?
Huh?
Jumana?
Well, yeah. Well, whoever the owner is.
No, Jumana is not the owner of the Boston Celtics. Jumana would be Jason Kidd's wife.
Okay, let her sit in the owner's box.
Yeah.
Even in Boston.
Well,
I
heard you talking about this yesterday, and with Warner, and I don't know what Jason Kidd's all upset about. I mean, if you bring your wife and your kid to the game...
First of all, don't hit her.
Well, that's
number
true.
Number one.
Well, exactly. Yeah. Well, listen, I'm not going to kill him, but people make mistakes, and hopefully he's moved on.
You get one punch, right, Sid?
One shot's enough, yeah.
Yeah, one shot. That's all I want.
He's moved on, obviously. He's sorry about it, and... But, you know, you don't bring it to the game, or you're just inviting trouble.
To the opposing
city. Yeah, I mean, that's silly.
And then somebody had a,
You just can't do that, you know? It's
Memorial Day weekend, everybody's drunk.
But don't sit in the middle of Boston Garden.
Right up front.
Kind of got to lay low a little.
What do you expect? I mean, you know, that's...
Wearing her Nets jersey.
Yeah.
And the kid's wearing the Nets jersey.
Hey, Jumana, how's it going, Jumana?
not right.
Takes. Odds are he won't live to see tomorrow.
to the new Wiz. We've got more jingling bells than ever before. You see, we've added extra cash registers because...
Responding for NBC News along. There are two of them. There's David Gregory and then there's Campbell Brown. And we were encouraging Gregory to ask the president tougher questions instead of being a milquetoast.
Right.
But I'm just goading, simply trying to cause trouble. I mean, I don't care what kind of questions you ask him, kinds of questions you ask. Who cares? I mean, I just don't. We were just trying to cause trouble, period.
Sure.
So here's what we need. We need to conduct a poll. And we can either do it at MSNBC or on the radio. If you want to call me, it's 1-800-370-IMUS, and IMUS on your phone is 4687. So 1-800-370-4687. And was Gregory, was he one? I'm gonna roll a clip here for you, and you can listen to it or watch it. And the question is, was Gregory showing off, and was he out of line? Now, he answered, it's a press conference with President Bush and the frog-leg-sucking French weasel. What's his name?
Jacques Chirac.
Yeah. And Gregory asked a question of the president, kind of a confrontational question. Mm-hmm. And then, well, here, listen. Roll it.
You said in reaction to demonstrations against you and your administration during this trip in Europe that it's simply a healthy democracy exercising its will and that disputes are positive. But I wonder why it is you think there are such strong sentiments in Europe against you and against this administration. Why particularly there's a view that you and your administration are trying to impose America's will on the rest of the world, particularly when it comes...